Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning. It's good to see you all on this Lord's Day, a special day for us, of course, because we're celebrating our seniors who are graduating very soon. And we're delighted that you're here, especially if you're visiting because your families or family members or friends of those graduates. We're glad you've chosen to worship here today. And if you are visiting, we would invite you to leave your name with us on the registration pad that you will find at the end of your pew, so that we can know just a little bit more about who you are. Again, it's good to see everybody for worship. Just a few announcements regarding the life of the church that I quickly want to make. I'll remind you that following the service today, we're having a meal in the fellowship hall to honor our seniors. We'll have a program then. So everyone's invited to stay and enjoy that time together. We'll hope you'll make time to do that. Next Sunday is Mother's Day, and we will be reflecting those themes in worship on that day. And then on the 11th, which is a Wednesday evening, we will be hosting the Coalition of Appalachian Ministry. You have an insert in your order about that. It's on the green sheet, and it's related to the craft sale that they will have here in our fellowship hall on that day. The items at the cabin that's owned by CAM, which our denomination supports, are made by local craftspeople in Appalachia, and then when we purchase those items, the money goes directly to the people who created the craft, so it's a way for them to sustain themselves. And this sale will be open to the public, other churches, anybody who wants to drop in from about 11 to 7 on Wednesday the 11th. So if you're coming for supper that night, you might want to come a little early and take a look at the items that will be for sale. And then the meal that night will be sponsored by Circle One, and we'll take donations only. And all those donations will go to support CAM, or the Coalition of Appalachian Ministry. All this information will be in your newsletter next week, too, so that you can follow up on that. The Sunday following that, the 15th, is Pentecost, and we've kind of developed a tradition of wearing red. So I'm giving you a heads up. You got 2 weeks to find something red to wear, which, of course, shouldn't be too big a problem for most of us. You'll also notice in your order of service an insert related to a dance production that will take place at Milligan College called The Wimmicks. It's based on a book by Max Lucado entitled You Are Special. And it tells a great story that is pertinent for children but also relevant for all of us. So you're invited to attend that. The dates are the 13th and the 14th of May. If you want more information, there's a website and a phone number where you can call, I think, get tickets, as well as learn a little bit more. So take that home with you. See if you and your family might want to go. And the children's sermon today, which Park Brummett will give, will relate that story to us in abbreviated form. Also, you'll notice we're making progress on the organ. We have the console in place, and also the framing for the holes. And by the end of next week, we anticipate that the organ will be complete. We're grateful for all of you who've worked hard to make that happen, and it has been certainly a group effort. I want to share prayer concerns with you now because we won't have a time later in the service to do that. Please remember John Array, who's recovering from surgery still. Karen Zimmerman's sister, who is facing chemotherapy treatments in the very near future. Jean Jenkins, who's recovering from pneumonia. Judith Plucker, who will be having surgery on Tuesday. And then also, please remember those who are grieving still among us, Emily Smith and Willetta Blakeburn. Let us worship God. The Lord be with you. Take delight in the Lord.
And it shall give thee the desires of your heart.
I know my plans for you, says the Lord.
Plans for good, not for evil, to give you a future and a hope.
Praise the Lord.
The Lord's name be praised.
Let us pray. Almighty God, source of life, we acknowledge that only by your providence do our lives unfold in a redeeming and joyous direction. You have watched over the birth and life of each one of us, and you have sustained the life of this congregation. Thank you for bringing us to this glad day when we rejoice in the hard work of these graduates, mark a time of great change, and prepare to face the future with hope. Abide with us as we enthrone you on our praises. Through Jesus Christ and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. We never graduate from our need for God's love, and God never graduates from loving us. Because we know God is merciful, we have confidence to admit our sin before God. Let us pray together. Wise and powerful God, you have given us your light and truth to guide us through confusion. Yet we have relied instead on human wisdom, and we have lost our way. You offer to share our burdens and to lead us through change. Yet we trust in our own effort and often find ourselves exhausted. Forgive us, for we are sorry for our lack of trust. Bring us back into your presence, O God. Overcome our separation from one another and from you. By your word and spirit, fill us with the gifts to meet life's demands. Keep us confident and connected to Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Hear the good news. For God so loved the world that God gave the only Son, so that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. For God sent the Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but so the world might be saved through him. Friends, trust what you hear. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Since God has welcomed us, we are free to welcome one another in the name of Christ. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
When I became Wyatt Farr's mentor, it began or continued a relationship that has been very special to me. I don't want to start this by getting tearful already, but Wyatt is a wonderful person. We had a lot of fun when we were going through confirmation. He was homeschooled at that time, so I didn't know much about homeschooling, but now I know more. He has been a delight to have in our church. He's shared his gifts in many, many ways, especially through mission trips and youth group and all sorts of musical things. In case you didn't know, he does play the ukulele and messes with the autoharp some too. Last summer, Wyatt and Mark and I were able to travel to Italy together with the Greeneville High School chorus, and that talk about sharing some gifts. They certainly did at that time. At Greeneville High School, Wyatt's been in the All-East Chorus and the All-State Chorus. He's in the National Honor Society and vice president of the senior class. One of his greatest accomplishments was playing Ala Kahim in the Oklahoma musical last spring. He will continue sharing his gifts at University of Alabama in Huntsville, where he's going to major in history and political science.
In the interest of full disclosure, I did not have the opportunity to be Mark McKee's mentor. Don McIntyre served in that way, and unfortunately Don couldn't be here this morning. I have had the opportunity to get to know Mark on a personal level, however, and am pleased to be here and speak on his behalf. In recent years, I've thought of Mark as this tall, erect, young oak sapling that sways in the breeze when he sings. I think you've seen it. I'd just like to suggest we think about Mark a little bit differently, not to exclude that, because those things are true. But Mark has proven himself in the academic arena. He's an honor graduate at Greeneville High School. He's been a regional mathematics winner 2 years in a row. Mark's also, like Wyatt, been very involved in the musical programs at school and here in this church. We've all been blessed by their performances, if you will. I think what stands out to me is the trios that Holden and Mark and Wyatt have done together have just been really meaningful to me personally, and I thank you for them. Mark's had the opportunity to perform at Carnegie Hall along with Wyatt and in Italy, and it's just amazing what these young people are able to do today. And I applaud those of you who take advantage of those opportunities. Mark's also been a leader. He's president of the student council. He's the very reliable captain and midfield steadying influence on Greeneville High soccer team. I've witnessed fact that he can sure take a lick also on the soccer field and get up and keep going, and I admire that. So Mark's also been involved in the youth programs in this church and participated in the Wood Ministry and understands what it is to serve. So I would say to you that maybe I should think of Mark more like a hula hoop, a very well-rounded young man who has a very bright future. He's headed to Vanderbilt University to follow the family trade of engineering. So,
Marley. It seems like only yesterday that we were going through confirmation together, and now here you are, ready to graduate from high school and begin a new chapter in your life. I still carry with me in my Bible the bookmark that we made, and it's a wonderful reminder of that special time that we spent together throughout the confirmation process. I've so greatly enjoyed watching you grow up over the years. You've meant so much to me and my family and to your church family. I want you to know that you are a very special person. I'm so very proud of you for the outstanding young lady that you have become and for the many worthwhile accomplishments that you've made already. And I know there are many more to come. I'm sure you've learned so much from each and every one of those activities that you've been a part of, and you will take what you have learned with you as they are building blocks for your future. You will take with you the values that your parents have taught you, as well as those that your church has instilled in you. Thank you for sharing your time and talents with your community and your church. And I'd like to share with you some of those school and community and church activities that Marley has been involved with over the years. At Greeneville High School, she's been on the varsity soccer team for 3 years. She has been serving on the student council for all 4 years, and this year she serves as treasurer. She's a member of the National Honor Society and the youth leadership. In the community, she's volunteered at the Boys and Girls Club youth soccer camp for 3 years. She's worked at the Humane Society, volunteered at the Clothes Closet, and that provides clothes for underprivileged high school students. She's provided photography services for various system-wide school events and fundraisers. She has won many honors and academic awards. She was recognized for AP Human Geography and Economics. She's a graduate of the Greenville-Green County Partnership Youth Leadership Program. And she also received a Senior Superlative Award, and I think this just says it all. She was voted best all around. She's also participated in so many church youth activities over the years. She's been to Resurrection, the Sugar Mountain Ski Trip, the Harvest Auction, the Super Bowl of Caring. She helped paint the youth rooms. She served as acolyte. She's helped with Everett's Endeavor, the Greene County Firewood Ministry, Youth Day, and the GHS Football Lunch. Marley has been very, very busy, and we appreciate everything that she's done for us here at the church. Marley will be attending UT in the fall. And Marley, as you head off to Big Orange Country, I hope that you know that you'll always hold a special place in my heart and also with your church family. We will always be here for you, no matter where life takes you. We wish you all the best with all your endeavors and pray God's continued blessings in your life. And of course, we hope you come back to visit us often.
I'm speaking about Joy Tweed today. I'm very pleased to have that honor. And as Joy Tweed's mentor in the confirmation process, I discovered early on that his faith journey began long before we had our first session. It was very evident to me that his familiarity with the Bible and the church had been learned at a home from a strong family of faith. Joy's been an active member of our church before and after confirmation. He currently serves as an acolyte, and I understand from Andy that he's been called on short notice many times to fill in, and we're grateful for that. He assisted with our Gabriel's program for a couple years. He's participated in both middle school and high school youth group. He's attended several resurrections like most of these kids. And he's worked with his family on our annual mulch party. We haven't done it this year, but he's worked several years with his family spreading mulch and doing the spring cleanup outside. He's involved in a lot of, in several community things. He has helped with Gift for Kids. He's helped with the wood ministry. And as a junior, he participated in the Greene County Partnership's Youth Leadership Program. As a youngster, Joy let his family know right away that he had a very special gift for things with wheels. His mother said he was born with a steering wheel in his hand. As she watched him drive around the house on a battery-operated four-wheeler at the age of two, even before two, before he was walking, and she had actually had to help him on and off the four-wheeler. By the age of six, he was on go-karts. By the age of eight, he was racing. He even learned to ride a motorcycle before he conquered the bicycle. You're talking about trusting parents. But they knew their boy. They knew him. As a member of a high school build a race car team, they didn't actually build a race car, but they had a chassis, and they used cardboard and other things to take care of the dynamics when it was racing. They actually went and competed in Indianapolis, not on the big track, but on another track. And while he was doing that, he took up dirt bike racing and even got involved with his dad on real dirt track racing. But now he's given up racing. Beginning last summer, he began working on diesel engines at Landmark Trucks. And this way he's able to continue his passion for cars, trucks, and motors. He's currently working some 20 hours a week and is pursuing certification as a diesel mechanic. Not because he plans to do that, but he's hoping that one day he'll be managing an outfit that handles trucks and diesel engines, maybe even own the company. Joy plans to enter ETSU in the fall and pursue a degree in business administration. Because of his schooling and work, he doesn't have a lot of free time, but he does like the music of the rock band AC/DC. And I asked him, what are your favorite subjects in school? And they were pretty similar to mine. He loves history and girls. I can remember how much fun that was. Recently, I asked Joy what he liked most about church. And I mean, he responded almost immediately that it was you, the members, because you have always been friendly, accepting, and welcoming of him. It's not surprising, then, that he shows the same kind of love and respect in his relationship with his parents and grandparents and the adults in this church. He's a very confident young man and with a healthy self-esteem, and he already understands that there's no elevator to success, that he's going to have to climb the stairs like everybody else. He knows the future is all his, and he's going for it. May God bless each step and watch over him on the way.
I don't know. I think it's on. Okay. All right. Good morning. I'm just going to put it in my lap. Does that still work? I'll put it there. Is that okay? I asked if I could not use that, and I was told no, I had to. Good morning. How are you guys this morning?
Good.
Good. I'm going to tell you a story about a group of little wooden people named Wemix. And even though this sounds like maybe it's a children's story for you, it's for you guys too, especially the seniors, because they're leaving their safe, comfortable net of all of us that they know, love, and accept them for how they are. So I was going to make you guys come and sit down here, but now that you have on those big robes, you don't have to. But okay. So the Wemix were little people, and they lived in a little village down below a place where the woodmaker who made them, Eli, lived. And all day long, they would run around, and they would stick stars and dots on each other. So if you got a gold star, maybe you had beautiful clothes or nice shiny paint, or you could jump high, or you could sing really pretty, and Wemix would stick a gold star on you. But if you weren't very good at jumping and you fell down, or you scratched your wood, or your paint was chipped, they would then give you a gray dull dot. And so all day long, they ran around, sticking gold stars and gray dots on each other. And there was one little Wemix named Punchinello. And Punchinello had lots of gray dots because he would fall down and scar his wood, and they'd give him a gray dot. And then he might try to explain why he fell down and say something silly, and they give him another gray dot. And they all told him he was not a very good person. And he started to believe that himself. And then one day he saw a little girl named Lucia. And Lucia had no stickers at all. She had no gold stars. She had no gray dots. And so he went and asked her, "Why don't they stick to you?" And she said, "Because I go see Eli every day." And he said, "Who's Eli?" And she said, "He's the guy that lives on the hill. Go see him." And he said, "He won't want to see me." And Lucia just went away, though. So he thought about it for a while, and he decided he wanted to not have any more gray dots on him. So he went to see Eli. And when he got there, he walked through the door, and Eli said, "Punchinello, I've been waiting. Been waiting for you to come." And he said, "You know who I am?" And he said, "Yes." So he picked him up and he put him on his workbench, and he looked at him and he said, "You have a lot of bad marks. You have a lot of gray dots." And he said, "I know, but I tried not to get them." And he said, "You don't have to explain that to me. I made you, and I think you're pretty special." And he said, "But why does Lucia not have any stars or dots?" And he said, "Because she comes and sees me every day." And so he thought, "Well, I don't understand." And he said, "That's okay. You have a lot of gray dots. You go and come back and see me every day." And every day, Punchinello went to visit his maker. And he started to realize that what his maker believed who he was much more important than what all the other Wemix thought about him. And slowly, all of his dots fell off of him. And he realized that what was in his heart, his maker saw what was in his heart and his true worth. And even though he had been labeled by all the other Wemix, he did not believe that anymore. So they didn't stick. They only stuck if he cared about what they thought. And so what this story of the Wemix is about, if we think about it in a different way, is that God made each of us just the way he meant for us to be. And we can get labels. Other people can tell us we're not very good at something, or that we need to work on something, and that we're not worthy of, we're not as good as this singer or as good as this dancer. But what you have to remember is God made you just how you were supposed to be, and he doesn't make mistakes. So you guys remember, as you go off, that some people, that's going to happen to you, because you're going to meet all kinds of new people who are going to challenge your faith and challenge who you are and where you come from, and you can't let those dots stick You've got to visit with your Maker. You've got to talk to God every day. So, and then try to do that to others. Don't put labels on others. Don't look at their outside. Look at their heart. So what do you think we should pray today? I was going to make a prayer, and then I decided that maybe you guys from this story might think of one or two things that we could say in our prayer. What could we... Okay, thank you for all the people and all our friends. What else? What about help us to remember to talk to you every day? And help us maybe to remember not to label other people, but look at their heart. Mm-hmm. Would that be good prayers?
And make sure it's big.
And make sure it's big. Uh-huh, and maybe that the seniors, when they go off to their colleges, will remember that God loves them and that he's made them the way they're supposed to be, you think? Okay, so.
To help the other people feel good, mm-hmm. who have cancer.
Mm-hmm, okay.
And not get dots on them.
That's right, and not let the dots stick. So let's do that one. I like that. I like them all, and so we can all say those prayers, and anything else you thought of, you can add in your mind to that prayer. But actually, when we did our confession this morning, the very last lines were very good, which said, to help keep us confident and connected to Jesus Christ, our Lord. And that's something that we want to do, okay? We can't rely on our human people labeling us. We have to remember to rely on Jesus. All right, so let's pray. And what did you say again? What was your prayer? Did you already forget?
Not to let the dots stick.
Not to let the dots stick. Okay, so let's bow our heads and pray. Dear Lord.
Dear Lord.
Help us to remember.
Help us to remember.
To visit with you every day. And to not believe the things that others say about us. But to rely on your love and strength. Amen. Okay. Now.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 16th chapter, starting in the 13th verse. If you'd like to follow along in your pew Bible, which is found under your seat, that would be found on page 895. Let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we ask that you would pour out your Spirit upon us. As we hear these words spoken by human lips, we ask that we would hear your word as it comes to life within us. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 20. Now when Jesus had come into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. Friends, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, how do you even respond to a question from Jesus like, "Who do you say that I am?" It's a question that's both too complex and too simple. So where do we even start? Well, every Saturday at our seminary, we have a guest who leads us in worship. And on one particular Saturday, it was an elderly Methodist minister who came in and he told us he had written a joke for an online joke contest. And I'm going to tell you the joke. He said Jesus and his disciples were sitting around, and Jesus asked the question, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter spoke up and said, "Well, Jesus, who do you think you are?" And Jesus said, "I think I'm God." And Peter said, "Wow, Jesus, that's a pretty bold claim. Why do you think that?" He said, "Well, every time I pray, I kind of just feel like I'm talking to myself." No, that was it. Did I mention he was a Methodist minister? Well, we know that a long jumper doesn't just stand at the line and jump as far as they can. They get a good running go at it. And so today, maybe before we tackle this question, maybe we need to back up just a little bit and try to gain up a little steam before we jump into the question, "Who do you say that I am?" So we find the question in Matthew 16. Why don't we back up to Matthew 15 and see how much steam we can gain? So we're going to start in Matthew 15, 29, if you'd like to follow along. And we're going to trust the subtitles in our Bibles and just kind of go through very quickly and see where it takes us. If we start in Matthew 15, 29, we find in this section, Jesus is surrounded by people who have come to be healed. There are many people around him with all kinds of physical ailments, and Jesus is happy to heal the people, and it says that they all praised God. Immediately following that, Jesus has compassion on the crowd, and it says he feeds over 4,000 people with 7 fish and a few small loaves of bread. The next section tells us that the Jewish leaders they're not really sure what they're seeing. And so they ask Jesus for a sign. It's as if the healing of the lame, the maimed, and the blind, and the miraculous meal on the mountainside wasn't enough. And so they're asking, Jesus, show us a sign. And we can almost feel Jesus' shoulders just drop in disbelief. So Jesus is still replaying these events in his mind when the disciples realize that they left the 7 baskets full of leftover fish and bread on the other side of the lake. We can just imagine the disciples standing behind Jesus, whispering among themselves, "You tell him. You tell him. I'm not telling him that we left the leftovers. I'm not telling him. You tell him. You're the one that's supposed to fix the lunches. You tell him." Well, while they're still having their quiet negotiation, Jesus turns around to them and he says, "Beware the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees." And I imagine the disciples say, "See? Yeast! Yeast is in bread. He is so mad at you. Can't believe you left that." But we see what's going on here. Jesus and the disciples are not on the same page. They may not even be in the same book, maybe not even in the same library. The disciples think that Jesus is talking about bread, but Jesus is more concerned about what he's just heard the religious leaders saying. "You fools," we imagine Jesus would want to say. "Are you even paying attention? All I've been doing is giving sign after sign after sign. And they had the audacity to ask for another sign." So they reach the place that they're going, and I imagine they sit around a campfire, and they're just staring at the flames. And Jesus breaks the silence. He asks, "Who do the people say that I am?" After the long day that they've had, I imagine Jesus is looking for a little reassurance from his inner circle. "Who do they even think I am?" It's the type of question that any of us could answer because there is no right or wrong. We're just reporting what somebody else has said. Well, the 3 answers that the disciples give are pretty honorable names. They say John the Baptist, Elijah, and Jeremiah. Any of us would be honored to be listed to be named in a list like that. And I imagine Jesus was probably honored himself. Jesus doesn't say that the people are wrong. He just encourages the disciples to dig a little deeper. What about you? Who do you say that I am? Oh, now, Jesus, that's a different kind of question. So let's find us a place to sit next to the fire and imagine Jesus has just looked at us. Well, if we start with the stories in the Bible, we might say Jesus is a teacher, a healer, a miracle worker, a preacher, a friend, a storyteller, a comforter, or a theologian. If we take Jesus at his word, we might say Jesus is the Son of Man, the Son of God, the bread of life, the door, the good shepherd, the resurrection and the life, the way, the truth, and the life, or the true vine. But what about you? Who do you say that I am? We're told that Jesus never changes. But can't our understanding of who Jesus is change? If we're honest with ourselves, our understanding of who Jesus is has probably changed 100 times in our life. It's probably going to change 100 more. So let's be honest with ourselves today, and let's look at some of the ways maybe we've answered this question of who do you say that I am? I don't think I'm the only one who has seen Jesus as the moral policeman. You know, Jesus, the one who knows all the rules and ruins all our fun. You know, Jesus, the one that we try so hard to please. The one that we do good things, go to church, say prayers before meals, just as long as Jesus is happy. This is the Jesus that, you know, maybe if we do one or two things wrong, maybe he'll forgive us, but if we really mess up, we better just stay away from this Jesus. Or what about the make-a-wish Jesus? After all, he did say, "Ask and it shall be given unto you." This is the Jesus that hangs out the most in the classroom right before the test. Or maybe he hangs out in the football stadium right before the big kick. But he also makes an appearance when we're looking for a front row parking space. He also hangs out in hospitals when we're waiting on our loved ones. Or maybe you're familiar with the ancient Jesus. That's the Jesus that was relevant thousands of years ago, but really doesn't mean much to us now. Or what about the bootstrap Jesus that's willing to help everyone as long as they prove that they're willing to help themselves? Or what about safety bubble Jesus, who will protect us from all harm and all sad feelings? How I wish I was making up this list about who I believe Jesus to be. But if I'm honest with myself, I have leaned on every one of these Jesuses. And I imagine I'll probably hang out with these Jesuses again in the future. I believe that Jesus never tells us that we're wrong in who we believe him to be. He only encourages us to dig deeper, to push further. Do you remember what Jesus said to Pilate when Pilate asked him directly, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "That's what you say." In other words, I can't answer for you who you say I am. As a side note, have you ever heard anyone called Jesus, or say Jesus is the answer? Jesus is the answer. I've heard that a lot. There's an author by the name of Martin Copenhaver, and he's pointed out that in the four Gospels, the four books that speak most explicitly about Jesus and his life, Jesus asks 307 questions. 307 questions. In those same books, Jesus is asked 183 questions. Now, these graduates were at the early service, so they can't answer, but of those 183 questions that Jesus is asked, how many of those do you think he answered? Do you guys remember? Hold it up high. 3 out of 183 questions. Jesus only answers 3 questions. And I don't think it's because he's a slippery politician. I think Jesus does not want the conversation to end. Jesus so many times will answer questions with a question. In fact, it's recorded in the Gospels several times that Jesus instructs his disciples not to reveal the things that they have learned about who he is. I've always wondered, why in the world would Jesus not want people to go and say what they've learned? I think Jesus wants each of us to have the conversation and to have a personal experience, to dig deeper. Well, when the disciples realized the question wasn't rhetorical and Jesus wasn't going to move on until someone said something, our friend Peter, who usually just blurts out the first thing that's on his mind, speaks up, but this time he is very clear and very confident. "You are the Messiah, the Redeemer, the Victor, the Liberator, the Savior. You're the Son of the Living God." If Jesus was to ask Peter maybe 24 hours later, Peter's answer might have been, "You're a good storyteller. But right now, he is so confident. You are the Savior, the Messiah. And this is Peter. Just a few chapters later, he denies even knowing Jesus. But Jesus will never stop asking the question. I think Jesus' hope for all of us is that we will continue to dig deeper and to ask more questions. I think that Jesus' hope for all of us is that our answer will shape our lives. Graduates, and I know we have some graduates back here too. I want to be honest with you today. The numbers are against us. The numbers, the research shows that 40 to 50% of students just like you who graduate from high school after being part of a supportive church or a youth group will drift away from God throughout their college years. That's what the research says. So if we're to believe this research out of the four of you sitting here, that's telling us that two of you will probably say that God is just not for me in the next 3 to 4 years. I don't like statistics. I choose not to believe that we are a part of those statistics. Because as you stood up here just a few weeks ago, we were all proud of the way you put your faith right out here before us. And you told us how strongly you believe. But we would be naive to pretend that the days are not coming when your faith will be challenged. We know that those days are coming. There's going to be days coming when you're going to drop one egg and you're going to think, maybe I should just throw out the whole dozen. That's not news to any of us. We all have hard days. But author Brennan Manning says that after thousands of hours of prayer and solitude, he is utterly convinced that when we come face to face with Christ, with Jesus, that he will have questions once again. Did you believe that I loved you? That I desired you? That I waited for you day after day? That I longed to hear your voice? Because I know your whole life story. I know every moment of sin, shame, dishonesty, and degraded love that has ever darkened your past. Right now, I know your shallow faith, your feeble prayer life, your inconsistent discipleship, and my word is this. I dare you to trust that I love you just as you are, and not as you should be, because you're never going to be as you should be. Jesus asks, how about you? Who do you say that I am? Your answer is never going to define who Jesus is, but it is going to define who Jesus is to you. My hope for you is that you will dig deeper, that you will keep asking questions, and you won't let the conversation end. Amen.
Thank you.
heaven and on earth, let us say what we believe through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Graduates, I ask you to stand again to receive this charge from the congregation. Join with me in the responsive charge. What shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us?
If God did not spare the only Son, but gave him up for us,
will not God also give us everything else with him? Nothing can separate us from the love of God.
Not life, nor death, nor anything in all creation.
Joey, Mark, Marley, and Wyatt, remember who you are.
You are a baptized child of God, a member of the family of faith, belonging to Jesus Christ our Lord.
Remember who you are.
You are a disciple of Jesus Christ, called to love God and neighbor in all your choices. And in your life's work.
Graduates, remember who you are.
You are gifted. You are rich in talents and abilities, waiting to be uncovered and shared with the world God loves.
Blessed are the pure in heart.
For they shall see God.
Let us pray. Eternal God, in this season of change, help us to know that you are always near, steady and strong. In this season of anticipation for these graduates, bring joy to their hearts and hope for tomorrow. In this season when they will look back over the course of their lives, give them gratitude for every experience that they have shared with family and friends and a sense of accomplishment. Eternal God, hold the parents of these young ones close to your heart, so that they will be able to let go as necessary and to hold on where needed. And keep all of us, we pray, one body in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
God is so good. With glad hearts, let us offer our gifts. Thank you. Let's pray. Praise to you, gracious God, for all your gifts given to us, all of which come from your hand. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who loves us so completely that we're never left without him, and for your Spirit, which gives us energy for life and creates in us the hope for eternal life. As we offer these gifts, we trust you to use them to bless the world you love and help us day by day to share your good news with others through our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Directions, and yet we will go nowhere where Christ is not already there. Keep digging deeper. Keep asking questions. And I forgot what the third one is. If I can't remember it, you can't remember it. Don't let the conversation end. Amen.
Thank you.
God's people say,